hoping to ask you about the possibility of a fourth wave, and people wanting to get tested for COVID keep reporting they're being turned away. So they lie and say they have symptoms. And some of those people initially turned away because they were asymptomatic have ended up testing positive. At this point, why not just let anyone seeking a test get one?
Yeah, so I've heard anecdotes of that as well. I know when I talk to my colleagues, our message out there is if you have any concerns, get tested, and we have testing available for people everywhere. Whether there's going to be a fourth wave, that is something that I think we are grappling with around the world. We know that this virus takes advantage anytime we give it people who are susceptible. And the means to be transmitted. So we do have to watch this. I think we are in a good place in BC. We've seen that the measures that we know work have made a difference. We're starting to see our curve come down, even as more and more people are protected through vaccination. But all bets are off if things change globally. And we need to understand that as we go into next respiratory season, so next fall, we may have to change some of the things that we're doing again. So if we look at this virus, like every virus, changes. That's its whole raison d'être, is to reproduce. And the more people that are infected, the more times it reproduces, the more chances that it's going to, a new mutation is going to arise that might give it some competitive advantage. And we've seen that most recently in India, sadly. And that's where the worry is that a variant could arise, a strain could arise that's transmitted more easily. That's what happens first. But as more people are being immunized, we might see a strain that is able to infect people who've been partially protected or have been protected from vaccine. So that is a worry. And that's something that we're monitoring. And the UK, of course, is looking at that right now. So how do we get protection levels up soon enough so that we don't give that type of a virus a chance to take hold again? So those are the things that we are watching really carefully. And it really is why, as a global community, we need to ensure that vaccines are available for everybody around the world, because we truly are not safe until everybody is safe. And we see that in countries like Brazil. We see that in India right now. We're seeing it in some countries that had previously not had severe outbreaks, in Vietnam and Indonesia, for example. So these are things that we have to pay attention to. Here right now in our bubble here in British Columbia, we're making a difference and we're getting people protected, and that's going to help us. But it may be in the fall. When we think about this, and my public health colleagues, we talk about the scenarios that are happening, I expect this virus will be with us for years. But how it impacts us will be very different than what's happening right now. We will go to it being a virus that causes sporadic outbreaks, maybe in long-term care homes, maybe in schools, maybe in congregate settings when we come together, but that most people will be protected through immunization, so we won't have the same effects of hospitalizations and deaths that we've seen in this past year. But we will need to do public health measures. So there may be times where people will need to stay home from school or work. They'll need to wear masks in certain situations. We'll need to make sure that we have rapid testing available to detect if somebody's sick, whether they have COVID or whether they have influenza or RSV. So these are all the things that we're planning for contingencies in the fall. I'm cautiously optimistic that we get to the immunization levels that we need to protect those most at risk in the next few months and get second doses in people, that we will not be in a pandemic anymore, but we will be in a place where we can manage this virus in our lives.
Marcella, do you have a follow-up?
It is basically to the question that I asked, is that if people are being turned away when they go to get tested because they're being told they don't have symptoms, why not just let people get tested? Because there are asymptomatic people that are saying that after they got tested, they were positive.
Yes, so what I've said is that if people are concerned, they've been exposed, and we're doing a lot of asymptomatic testing and people have been exposed. If people have somebody they know who's been exposed or tested positive, then absolutely they should be tested.
Dr. Hill, you mentioned the possibility of a fourth wave depends on what happens globally. The head of the World Health Organization has asked wealthier nations to postpone plans to give children and teenagers COVID vaccines and instead donate supplies to lower-income countries. Is this something you would support?
So this is something that we've talked about with my colleagues across the country and the Council of Chief Medical Officers of Health. We've talked about it here. One of the key factors that went into us determining that we didn't need more AstraZeneca vaccine and that we were going to reserve the supply we had for second doses and for people who can't, for a variety of reasons, have the mRNA vaccines, was because we didn't want to draw more from the global supply of this very important vaccine and make sure that it's available where it's needed in places like India and other places. So we have considered that, and we have an adequate supply of the messenger RNA vaccines to be able to satisfy all of our needs here in British Columbia. So it is a very complex issue for a variety of different reasons. One is the mRNA vaccines are much more challenging to store and to move about, and they're very delicate, even though that's getting better. So that's their usefulness in many countries is a challenge because there may not be access to the type of freezers, etc., that are needed. So that's where the vaccines like the AstraZeneca vaccines are so important globally. That did factor into our decision-making about how we were going to continue to use AstraZeneca or not here in the province. We also looked at the impact of immunization in children. And there are many communities in our province where the demographics tend to be younger. And younger people, especially teenagers, are a larger proportion of that community. And providing protection to the whole community or to the large multi-generational families or to the environment where they're working or living is dependent on them being protected as well. We know that children tend to have milder illness, but it is not insignificant for many children, and we've seen that unfortunately here in BC too. So we did make the decision in Canada that it was important for us to protect that segment of our population, and we're moving ahead with that vaccine program. But clearly, we need to be part of the global community to provide vaccines for other countries. And, I've said this so many times that we are not safe until we're all safe. And that includes providing as much vaccine as we can to countries globally.